Hello, everybody. Welcome to today's Kubernetes Masterclass, brought to you by Rancher, now a part of SUSE. Today is Tuesday, March 9th, and we are going to be talking about the new monitoring capabilities today in Rancher 2.5. So while we wait for people to get logged in and situated, going to go over a few housekeeping items so you guys know what's going on with the class here. So I am your host, Connie Lin. I am a global events manager here now at SUSE. And our speaker today is field engineer Bastian Hoffman. And we are also joined today by David Holder, also a fellow field engineer. David and Bastian, you guys there? Want to say hello real quick, make sure your audio is good.
Certainly. Hello, good evening, good afternoon, good morning, everyone, depending where you are. I'm excited for the next hour to show you a bit more about monitoring and also how to migrate from the 2.4 to the 2.5 monitoring.
Excellent. Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for joining us today. And yeah, look forward to seeing what questions come in.
Great. Thank you, Bastian. Thank you, David. Glad to have you guys on today. Before we jump into the presentation, just wanted to go over a few details. It's been a few weeks since we have run our last masterclass. So just a reminder that these sessions usually run between 45 to 75 minutes. Please feel free to ask any questions you have along the way as we're talking about the topic. There is a questions tab in your GoToWebinar panel, and you can just type your questions in there, and we'll do our best to answer them along the way or address them at the Q&A session towards the end. If you have not yet, we have a channel dedicated to the masterclass series in the Rancher users Slack. So head over to slack.rancher.io, and that's available to you anytime. So even after this session wraps up, you can continue to pop your questions in this Slack channel. And with that, I will hand it over to Bastian to dive into today's topic.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Today I want to show you what is new in the new monitoring version. We call this version 2 of the monitoring that was introduced with Rancher 2.5, and especially also how you can migrate from the monitoring that was previous there in Rancher 2.4 to the new version. Because it is not a one-click upgrade, you need to do a couple steps to get your modifications and your previous settings that you and customizations that you did to the V1 monitoring over to the new V2 monitoring. And also, I'm going to talk a bit why that is even. So, agenda for today is we are going to talk about what is new in monitoring V2 compared to V1. I'm going to talk a bit about the backgrounds of the new monitoring, how it is powered by the Prometheus operator. And then we're going to have a lot of hands-on practical demonstrations, first of all, of how to install and actually use the monitoring V2, how to scrape and visualize, and then also add your custom metrics to it, custom dashboards, how to configure alerting. And then we're going to have a look how this compares to V1, and how you can then migrate from a V1 to a V2 installation. And it's going to be full of demos. So I like to do demos in my presentations. Of course, something can break in between, but let's hope for the best. At least I did my prayers to the demo gods above. But let's start first with a couple of slides. And by the way, if you have questions in between, please feel free to just pop them into the questions panel. Either David is going to be directly answering them, or is going to collect them, and we'll talk about this in between when there is some time or at the end. So let's talk about what's new in monitoring V2 first, and how does it compare to V1. Both monitoring versions, V1 and V2, are both powered in the background by Prometheus, Grafana, and Alert Manager. So the actual tooling is the same. You have Grafana to visualize dashboards and visualize metrics. You have Alert Manager sending out alerts based on alerting rules to some receivers. And you have Prometheus as a metric store who scrapes all the metrics from all the different components of your cluster and from your own applications and makes these available for Grafana and Alert Manager. Also, internally, to manage all these services, both V1 and V2 monitoring are using a Prometheus operator. And actually, even the same one, just in a bit of different versions, like V2 is using a new version of the operator. The difference is the way that Rancher then provisions and deploys this operator and the resulting Prometheus, Grafana, and Alert Manager instances, it's technically very different and much closer to what everyone else is doing upstream with the Prometheus operator Helm charts. And because of that, the new V2 monitoring is a lot more flexible. It is much better and easier customizable, and also brings you much more functionality directly out of the box. It includes a lot more metrics directly for you available that can tell you everything that is happening inside of your Kubernetes cluster with the control plane and with your workloads. It is also including a lot of more alerts out of the box and a lot more Grafana dashboards out of the box to visualize all these metrics, so that you don't have to start from scratch with everything. You can just start installing the V2 monitoring and directly start using it. It is fully customizable by that, so it brings you a lot out of the box, but you can customize it with your own dashboards, with your own alerts, with adding metrics for your own services. And you can do this much easier than with the V1 monitoring, especially in terms of alerting. And to provide all that, the V2 monitoring uses a customized version of the Kube Prometheus Stack Helm chart. And this is a Helm chart that helps you deploying everything of that around that. And since this is very customizable, it is also possible to directly include third-party tools like database operators, for example, directly into the Rancher monitoring. So even if you install any kind of other Helm charts that directly support Prometheus, you don't even have to configure anything anymore in the Rancher monitoring, and it will directly pop up. So the underlying technology is much more powerful, it's much easier to customize. But still, from the integration point of view, also with the V2 monitoring, you have a one-click installation, you have nice UI integrations, and you have all the ease of use that you came to expect from Rancher. Before we go into more details how this all looks in the product, let's take a couple of minutes to quickly talk about operators. Because I have been saying Prometheus operator one or two times already, and maybe not everyone is familiar with the term and what it actually means in the case of Kubernetes and what an operator in Kubernetes actually is. One of the great things of Kubernetes is, or the great thing of Kubernetes is, that it standardizes how you can deploy your applications, how you can provide compute resources to your applications, to your containers, and how to set up networking and service discovery in between them. And Kubernetes standardizes all of these with its API that looks the same regardless where Kubernetes is running, if it's running somewhere on a developer laptop, if it's running on your servers on-premise, if it's running in the cloud, if it's running on some edge devices. The standardized Kubernetes API always looks the same. The second great thing about Kubernetes, that this API is not only limited to things that Kubernetes knows about, but it's also extensible. That means you can extend the Kubernetes API with new API types, with new resource types, with new operations, which makes it a lot easier to integrate additional tooling into Kubernetes and then provide higher level abstractions based on the same Kubernetes tooling kubectl, Kubernetes YAML, the CI/CD tools that you are already using. And you can extend the Kubernetes API by creating so-called custom resource definitions. A custom resource definition is also a Kubernetes API object. And if you create one, you extend the Kubernetes API to understand additional resource types. An additional resource type could be, for example, a certificate or a MySQL cluster or a Prometheus instance. And then once Kubernetes understands these resource types, you can then deploy additional controllers into your cluster, additional pods into your cluster that just listen against the Kubernetes API on the creation, change, updates, and deletion of these resource types and perform the necessary action. For example, for a certificate resource, you could imagine that there is a pod that constantly listens on the creation of certificate resources. And if you create one, this controller will then go to, let's say, Let's Encrypt, and it will request a new TLS certificate and then also handle renewal and the whole challenge mechanism that Let's Encrypt has. And these controllers that extend the Kubernetes API are also called operators. And one of them is the Prometheus operator that powers the monitoring under the hood that Rancher uses. And the Prometheus operator is, in the end, a pod that, based on some custom resource definitions, helps you to manage and configure Prometheus and Alert Manager and Grafana in your cluster. To do this, it introduces a couple new API types. It introduces two API types for managing the actual workloads, a Prometheus resource type and an Alert Manager resource type. If you install the monitoring V2, these Prometheus and Alert Manager resource types will actually be created automatically, but you can then also use the Prometheus operator to install, for example, multiple Prometheus instances or multiple Alert Manager instances, which can be interesting for multi-tenancy cluster use cases. The second set of new resources that you have available through the Prometheus operator are resources that you can use to configure Prometheus. Prometheus itself basically has one large configuration file, which is written in YAML. And this configuration file then includes basically configurations for all the additional services and applications that Prometheus should scrape to get metrics, as well as all the alerting rules. They're all in one big configuration file. If you now have a Kubernetes cluster and you have 20 applications in that, it can be kind of tedious, especially also if you think about role-based access control, to configure scraping these 20 applications from within one big configuration file. And especially since you have a Kubernetes cluster, you're probably also always deploying new applications, removing old ones, scaling them up and down. And by having to write this configuration for Prometheus always manually, it creates a lot of work. That's why with the Prometheus operator, you have a couple resources, a service monitor and a pod monitor resource, in which you can configure which services and pods within your cluster Prometheus should scrape for metrics, and then Prometheus rule configuration objects, which then contain all the alerts you want to have in Prometheus based upon the metrics you scrape. And the Prometheus operator will then look at all these service monitors and pod monitors and Prometheus rule objects in your cluster, write this one big Prometheus configuration file in the background, and give it to Prometheus and reload it so that you don't have to write this one big single configuration file. You just can put the service monitors, pod monitors, and rules in the namespaces where you want. So if we look at this whole process in a bit more detail how this looks like. And this is a bit simplified even. You have the Prometheus custom resource that is created in the cluster. When this is there, a Prometheus operator pod sees this resource and it will create the necessary Kubernetes stateful sets and pods for Prometheus. So these here. And these Prometheus pods are first of all monitored and also managed by the Prometheus operator. So if anything goes wrong, it will fix the problems automatically. And also it will then discover all the service monitors and pod monitors in Prometheus rules and write this one single Prometheus configuration file and reload the configuration. So this is the Prometheus operator and how it basically works. And of course, I omitted the whole alert manager stuff, and I also omitted everything with Grafana for now to not make the diagram completely complicated or even more complicated. Rancher Monitoring V2 uses then an additional Helm chart to deploy the Prometheus operator, and not only the Prometheus operator, but lots of dashboards and service monitor configs and Prometheus alerts directly with one chart. And this Helm chart that Rancher Monitoring is using is called Kube Prometheus Stack. And Rancher takes this upstream chart and then modifies it so it works really well together with Rancher and directly integrates into the K3S control plane, the RKE control plane, the cloud providers, and so on. And by that, you not only get a Prometheus operator, this Helm chart also will directly deploy everything else that you see with monitoring tool, which is a completely pre-configured Prometheus instance, alert manager, configurable Grafana, Kube state metrics, a tool that provides Prometheus style metrics from the Kubernetes API about all the objects inside of Kubernetes cluster. It will deploy tools that provide you Prometheus metrics from the Kubernetes control plane and etcd instances from the nodes within a Kubernetes cluster. It will deploy a lot of Grafana dashboards, a lot of alerts, and also an adapter for the horizontal pod autoscaler so that you can also use all the Prometheus metrics in your autoscaling decisions. And to start off with, let's have a look at a short demo, how this is all possible with Monitoring V2. And then afterwards, we can have a look at how you can get your Monitoring V1 comparably into the Monitoring V2 and how to migrate it. Okay, what I have prepared here in my Rancher instance, in my Rancher setup here, this is running the newest and latest Rancher 2.5.6. And there are a couple of clusters here. I have two prepared. One is called Monitoring V2 and one Monitoring V1. The V1 one we are going to use later for actually doing the migration. Let's look into the Monitoring V2 cluster first. So the Monitoring V2 cluster is in this case running on the DigitalOcean on 3 nodes. Doesn't matter too much. The monitoring works the same regardless of the cloud provider, of the infrastructure, or the Kubernetes version. To access the V2 monitoring, we have to go into the Cluster Explorer. And from there, you can install the monitoring from the application marketplace. And in the application marketplace here, you have all the Rancher applications, partner applications, and maybe also applications from your own repositories available. And one of them is the monitoring application. If you install it, you can choose the version. So we pick the latest. And what you can then also do, you can do some configurations on how Prometheus should look like, how much storage you may want to give Prometheus, how long it should keep data inside of its storage, how much CPU and memory you want to give it. you can configure alerting, and the same way you can also configure Grafana. And there are also some more general settings, which distribution you're running, where the certificates are. And these are just basic functionalities that are exposed to a form. But you can also go and edit this whole monitoring system as YAML, and then you have tons of different options and things you can configure to do more advanced stuff. For example, configure things like Prometheus Federation, configure things like long-term storage with tools like Thanos or InfluxDB or other external long-term storage databases. This is all possible then in the YAML configuration. What I did is I just installed it with the standard basic settings. I clicked on install beforehand, and then it installs the monitoring application. And from there, once it's installed, we have a new section here in the Rancher UI for our monitoring stack. And this monitoring section gives me access to the currently firing alerts. It gives me access to all the tools, Grafana, Alert Manager, Prometheus, to their web UIs. And it gives me access to all the custom resources and custom resource definitions with which I can configure the monitoring. So service monitors, pod monitors, alerting rules and receivers, but also the alerting rules. And I could even set up new and additional Prometheus instances here in my cluster if I wanted.
A couple of questions, yeah? If you don't mind, Bastian.
Sure, that's a good point.
So first question, Kevin. Have we got any integration with AWS SNS? I know they've got a alert manager forwarder, but I'm not sure if that's something we can natively integrate.
I would need to look into this. I actually don't know. So if it is possible to integrate alert manager with the AWS service, then it will also work with the Rancher alert manager, because it, in the end, it is a native alert manager. So you could just probably use the same forwarder. You just have to deploy it manually. It's not a click in the UI.
Excellent. And the second question for now, sorry, is alert manager different from Prometheus alerts?
So alert manager is its own standalone project, but it's part of the Prometheus project, basically. It's two different services, but it is the Prometheus alert manager, and it is Prometheus. In the end, you get Prometheus alerts, yes.
Excellent. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Okay, before we customize this, let's have a look at what is actually possible here out of the box. So if we look at the targets that are already automatically scraped by Prometheus, we see that first of all, the monitoring scrapes itself to see if it's healthy. It also scrapes the Kubernetes controllers, etcd, the kubeproxy instances, the schedulers, and all the different exporters that provide me Prometheus metrics. So a lot of things are already directly in there and scraped automatically. So I have, for example, tons of metrics already available. And based on these metrics, the monitoring system directly gives me a huge set of alerts that just make sense in any kind of Kubernetes cluster. Like alerts that alert me if my monitoring stack is not working, if etcd is slow or has a lot of failed requests, if the API from Kubernetes is returning too many errors, if maybe container is in a waiting state, or a horizontal pod autoscaler is maxed out and would like to scale up but is not allowed to anymore, if a cron job is failing or a pod is crashing or not ready for too long, this all will be directly alerted out of the box, as well as if I'm overcommitting on CPU, if some containers are throttled, if persistent volumes are full or filling up, if Kubernetes certificates are expiring, if nodes are down, if the file system is maybe full of the nodes, if the clocks of my nodes are maybe not synchronized anymore, tons of stuff is already in there, which means I can then just take this, configure where these alerts should go to, and then I can focus on creating the alerts for my own workloads, for my databases, my APIs, and don't have to care about all the basics. And the same is true not only for alerts, but also for dashboards and visualizing all these metrics. So I get a Grafana instance here, and this Grafana instance comes with lots of dashboards pre-configured that show me the overall state of the cluster, as well as the state of the nodes in my cluster. So here I have my three nodes. I can see CPU usage, load, memory usage, disk usage, network usage. So these are basically doing nothing at the moment, but not only from the nodes, but also I get metrics from the Kubernetes control plane. So maybe let's have a look at the API server dashboard. So I see lots of detailed metrics of my Kubernetes API server and how that one is doing. I also have a dashboard for my etcd to see how that is, to visualize and see how that is doing. And I, of course, can also dive into not only the control plane components and the nodes, but then also into my individual containers. And there are different dashboards for different ways how to look at my workloads. So for example, one that is more pod-centric, I also have namespace-centric ones and deployment-centric ones. And here I can go, for example, look into a shop namespace and have a look at the CPU and memory usage, either overall or quota-based percentage-wise, as well as network I/O of my containers and pods. Again, everything comes out of the box here. I don't have to configure or click anything, but it is fully customizable, and we're going to see this in a second, so I can add my own dashboards to it, and I can focus again on the stuff that is necessary and important for my applications and don't have to care about the basics. So how can we then customize this? To show this, I beforehand, in preparation, deployed a small microservice shop application into my cluster. And this microservice shop also contains a Redis in-memory cache. And this Redis in-memory cache, at the moment, it's just running at one pod. And this pod has a Redis container inside and also a Redis exporter container inside here that connects to this internal Redis container and provides then metrics in a format that Prometheus understands, because Redis doesn't support Prometheus format out of the box. That's why I have this additional exporter in here. We can also have a look just quickly at the YAML definition of this Redis deployment. So this is my Redis deployment. I have one Redis container listening on port C6379. And in the same port, I have my exporter, which connects over localhost to port 6379 by default and opens up port 9121 to provide metrics for Prometheus. I also have a service to expose this metric port internally in the cluster, then through a service and to a fixed IP address and a DNS name. If we now want to scrape this, we have to create a service monitor inside of our cluster. To configure Prometheus to additionally scrape this our Redis instance. And this is how it looks like. I created this beforehand because it's going to take a couple of seconds until the configuration is rewritten. So we place, in this case, the new service monitor resource into the same namespace as our Redis, into the shop namespace, It could also be in a different namespace. It depends how you want to do role-based access control. And this service monitor now says, please, Prometheus, scrape in the shop namespace. We could also add multiple namespaces on here in here, or just leave this off. And then it would just take the same namespace where the service monitor is in. In this namespace, please select all services with this label here, app Redis card. So here you can see the label. And take the endpoints behind the service, so our pod, and there scrape the metrics port. So metrics port 9121. Every 30 seconds with a timeout of 20 seconds under the and do an HTTP request to the slash metrics path. I can also do more configuration options here. I could configure TLS settings, authentication, bearer tokens. There are more settings available, but these are kind of the basics. And before I forget this, let's maybe also create this one here directly. And now we can go back into the monitoring section here. Under service monitors, we can see that and of course I'm in the wrong cluster. Sorry about this. I should have looked at this further. So let's go to the correct cluster, the V2 cluster, and let's create the service monitor inside our cluster. Let's directly also create the Prometheus rules object for later. And now you can see, yeah, our service monitor is here. So we have the information in the cluster. And if we go back to our Prometheus, we should see under service discovery, and maybe this is gonna take now a second longer, but we should see in a second that our Redis instance will appear here. Let's wait for a couple minutes or a minute for that, because there is some caching involved to not reload Prometheus all the time for every configuration change. Let's look a bit further, because once we have the metrics available, here it is already. Okay, it was faster than expected. So here it is, there's now the information that Redis should be scraped for metrics. We can also have a look at the targets list and should see here, yeah, Redis, it also worked. It scraped my Redis instance. And we now have in Prometheus Redis metrics available. For example, a Redis up metric. Next step is that we now want to create a dashboard for Redis inside of our Grafana instance. And of course, we could log in here now and we could import or click together our dashboards ourselves. Or we also provide the dashboard through Kubernetes objects. And the way we can provide dashboards through Kubernetes and through the Kubernetes API to Grafana is by creating a config map with the content of the Grafana dashboard. So this is the JSON representation of a Grafana dashboard that I just pulled out of the Redis exporter Git repository. It's just a dashboard that is provided by the Redis exporter. I just put all the JSON in here inside of a config map. And then I'm creating this config map in the Kettle dashboards namespace. And then I'm adding this Grafana dashboard equals one label to it. And Grafana will actually look at all the config maps that have this label inside of this namespace and also automatically add them to the Grafana instance as a dashboard. So I can say, okay, let's create here our dashboard config map. And if we do a refresh here now in Grafana, and we look at the dashboards, we can see our Redis dashboard is now also here. And if we just put the time frame to the last 5 minutes, you can also see data is appearing inside of the dashboards here about our Redis instance. So just with Kubernetes YAML files, through our CSV pipelines, maybe also through Helm shards if they include the same resources, or with just using kubectl and the Kubernetes API, we can configure Prometheus and we can configure Redis. And this is like a huge thing that makes it a lot easier to manage a monitoring system in a cluster that hosts like dozens or even hundreds of applications. And the same thing is also true for alerts. So here we can create for alerts a Prometheus rule object. We also put this one into the shop namespace. It could also live in other ones. And then we have here a set of rules with Prometheus alerting rules. So every alert here has a name, a Prometheus query. And if this query returns data, in this case for 5 minutes, an alert is going to be sent. There are labels attached to the alerts, for example, a severity label. I also could do any other label. So I could say team alpha, because the team alpha is responsible for this alert. And then in annotations, I can put in a summary and description with the text that should be sent to through an SMS, through a text message, through an email, through a Slack message, if this alert fires, so that I actually can identify and know what is happening there. And I also created this one like a couple of seconds ago beforehand here. And if we go back to our Prometheus instance and we go to alerts, we can see, hey, our Redis alerts are also here. And the last thing I can do then in customizations is I can now have now to decide where these alerts should go to. For this, I can create as many receivers as I want to. And a receiver could be Slack, it could be an email, it could be a PagerDuty text message, it could be a webhook to just integrate with any kind of ticketing system, or it could also be any kind of custom configuration that Alert Manager supports. And with that, we probably can also integrate the AWS SNS that we just talked about. So let's maybe just do a webhook for now. And this one is, of course, something completely invalid. And create this. And now with alerting routes, we can configure which alerts should go to which receiver. And we can either say all alerts should go to this receiver, to this webhook, or maybe only alerts with certain labels. For example, maybe only the alerts with the team alpha label should go to our webhook, and maybe only the alerts with the team alpha label and the severity critical should go there. And with that, I can configure a completely as complex as I want alert routing, and can create as many routes as I want to get the alerts that need to go somewhere directly to the teams responsible for it. Okay. Insert all the code examples that you can see here are also publicly available inside of a Git repository, and the URL is inside of the slides, and you will receive the slides later on tomorrow or so via email. So if you don't want to do a screenshot now or type it off, you can revisit this later on to have a look at it. And before we go now to monitoring V1 and how to migrate it to this system, maybe we have the time to answer a couple more questions. Is there something, David, that would fit now?
Yeah, certainly. There's quite a lot of questions coming in, so that's great. There's a lot of people very active. So So a question that's come up, do I need to install the metrics server to receive metrics from the API server, etcd, and other Kubernetes components?
No, you don't have to. The metrics server in Kubernetes is actually only there to provide metrics for the horizontal pod autoscaler and these kubectl top commands to get the current CPU and memory usage of containers. The monitoring system is independent and not dependent on the metrics server.
Excellent. And we've had quite a few questions surrounding how we can monitor multiple clusters in a federated fashion, including lots of small edge clusters.
Mm-hmm. These are very good questions. And as you can imagine, there are probably like 12 different answers to that. One thing you can do is you could say, okay, I have this monitoring application that I can just install here. And I can just install it in every cluster and have a local monitoring available. That's great. And then I can create maybe a more central infrastructure cluster, also install the monitoring application in there. And then inside of this central cluster, I could say, okay, I'm also going to create probably automatically additional service monitors here that then won't scrape applications that run inside of this cluster or services that can run inside of the cluster, but an external service. And this external service could be the federation endpoint of an external Prometheus running inside of another cluster. I'm wondering actually if I have an example for that here, and I fear not in this repository, but maybe in another one, how such a service monitor could look like. So this is definitely one way you could go about this. And for edge clusters, you could even say, I'm not deploying on the small edge clusters because they only have limited CPU memory. I'm not deploying a whole complete Prometheus, but maybe only some exporters like the node exporter and the kube state metrics exporter. And then I'm only scraping these. So that also would be possible. So let's maybe see, do I have I don't have this ready as an example, but just here this would be the second use case. I have an external cluster could be an edge cluster, and in my central cluster I'm now creating a service monitor to monitor my edge clusters and maybe the node exporter application and the kube state metrics application. And the service monitor is of course first referencing an internal service inside of the cluster, but this internal service is then actually an external name service. And this external name service then has endpoints to some external IP addresses in here, and that could be then the edge cluster. So I could do such a federation by just adding a couple more services and service monitors to a central cluster that then go either to a remote Prometheus or even just remote exporters. That is one way to go about this. Of course, there are other ways. You could also use something like long-term storage clustering solution like Thanos. This is possible. It depends a bit on your use cases and how many clusters you have, how far away they are from each other, what monitoring data you actually want to have, and also how much resources you have available and who should have access to what monitoring data as well.
Excellent. There's been a few questions on pretty much the same subject, so I'll just generalize it by saying, say we've installed the monitoring framework and we've created our own service monitors, we've customized it. How do we go about backing up this configuration and potentially restoring it should we need to do so?
Easiest option is, so first of all, I of course always recommend to use a CI/CD system to actually create all these, maybe click them together, copy the YAML file into Git repository, store it there and roll it out from there. And of course, also something that you always should do is you should make backups of your clusters. And if you do a snapshot like this from your cluster, it will also back up the complete monitoring configuration and system. And then this way you can also restore it again.
Excellent. A very specific question regarding Thanos. Can Rancher monitoring auto sync default alerts installed by Rancher to Thanos alerts?
I would need to look this up, but since in the end these are just Prometheus alerts, it should actually work, but I haven't tried it out. So the alerts itself that come out of that, if you create this, these are just like standard Prometheus alerts. So they should actually sync, but I need to try it out. I haven't tried this, sorry.
Excellent. And is there any kind of default data retention policies implemented by this monitoring stack? So in terms of how many number of days Prometheus stores metrics, all that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. This so the default is 10 days that is configured here, but I can change this. I could also say 1 hour if that can make sense maybe for edge clusters, because I don't need monitoring data for that long there, and maybe I don't have much disk space and memory there, so I want to keep less retention. I could of course also say 20 days, but there keep in mind that Prometheus itself is not meant as a long-term metric storage, just by the way it works. For example, there is no aggregation mechanisms that maybe recalculates older data to save space. So the usual way is to say, okay, Prometheus itself has a short retention, so maybe something like 10 days or even less, or maybe a bit more. And then you can hook up additional long-term monitoring and metric storages, something like Thanos, like InfluxDB, maybe an Elasticsearch. So there are different options, and you can hook them up to the Prometheus instances. And depending on the solution, there are different ways. One of them is to use a feature of Prometheus that is also exposed through the configuration here called remote read and remote write. And with a remote write endpoint, Prometheus would save all the metrics it receives also to an external database. And this external database, something like InfluxDB, for example, like Elasticsearch, like Thanos, could, and there are probably 10 more I'm forgetting about now, they can then also store the metrics and also recalculate them, so that if they grow older, you have less retention, you only have like a metrics points every 5 minutes or so to make all of that actually storable, all this metrics data. And with the remote read integration, you can then also tell Prometheus, okay, if you get a query, Prometheus, and the data, you already have the data, just serve it. But if the data is older and you don't have it anymore, go to this remote database and try to fetch it from there. So that is then a seamless integration. So this is one way. Okay, looking at the time, I would say we have a look at V1 and how to migrate it to actually this V2 integration. To cover that within the hour, and then we'll definitely have time for more questions afterwards, but I want to cover that for the people who have to leave on time. Great. So let's have a look at our other cluster here, this monitoring V1 cluster. And what I did in preparation is, inside of the monitoring V1 cluster, I activated the V1 monitoring for the cluster. I also have a default project here with my shop namespace. It has the same Redis application that you already saw. And this application here on this V1 monitoring cluster, this default namespace also has here some project monitoring for the default project enabled. And let's maybe then also edit here the Redis deployment in the advanced options, so that we also scrape, and now I've already forgot the port, also scrape our Redis instance here. So we scrape port 9121 under /metrics. So this is the equivalent of creating a service monitor in V2 and V1. So we should get this in here. We can also maybe create an alert in here to also be able to migrate this. So let's call this Redis down maybe. And let's also say this is Redis up equals 0. And that should be critical. So that's fine. And let's maybe also edit this here, this alert group, and put a receiver in here. And I created this receiver beforehand. It's also just a dummy webhook, just so that we have this all configured. Great. So we have an alert. We are instructed our monitoring system in V1 to also scrape this Redis instance. Note that we can't really do this with YAML. We actually have to click this together. Last thing is, let's go maybe here into the apps and let's have a look at the dashboards here. So we should now, just to double check, under service discovery, we don't have our Redis instance yet in here, so probably we have to wait a couple of seconds more. But what we already can do is we can log in into this Grafana here and maybe also add a dashboard for our Redis instance. And let's take the dashboard, and I forgot the ID, but I wrote this down. Let's add this dashboard, which is the one you already saw beforehand. Let's just import this here into Rancher Monitoring. And so we have a dashboard. Does this already have metrics? It looks like it. So let's go to the last 5 minutes. And you can see the first dots appearing here. And this also has now worked. So I have my Redis instance in here. So that was basically kind of like the manual clicking around V1 equivalent of scraping the Redis, adding an alert, adding a dashboard. How do we go now from migrating all our customizations that we have, including the notifier that is in here? So our webhook notifier to V2. Let's do 2-3 slides for that first, before we to explain this first. One thing is, in the end, it's both Prometheus and Alert Manager, but the way it is deployed is so different that there is no possibility to do a direct in-place upgrade. That means to upgrade from V1 to V2 monitoring, you have to do some manual steps. First of all, V1 and V2 monitoring are supported and available side by side. You can't install both within a cluster, but you can run one cluster with monitoring V1, and you can run another cluster with monitoring V2, and you can upgrade to Rancher 2.5, and at any point in time, you can say, oh, now I'm ready, and this cluster, I want to migrate now from V1 to V2 monitoring. And the upgrade steps then are, first, I have to export all the modifications I did. I have to export the rules, the dashboards, and my notifiers, and my scraping information. Then I have to completely uninstall monitoring V1, because otherwise, if it's still installed, it will conflict with monitoring V2, and both the Prometheus operator instances, they will basically completely fight against each other and destroy your complete monitoring system. So you first have to uninstall it, and then you can install the V2 monitoring and then apply the exported V1 modifications to the V2 monitoring set. This process is also documented in our documentation. So there is an extensive migration guideline that we can just have a look at. So If we go to the documentation, there is in the docs under monitoring Rancher 2.5, migrating to Rancher 2.5 monitoring, a detailed page that explains the whole process, how to migrate everything manually. And to make this even a bit easier, Arvind, a colleague of mine, and I put a bit of time and work into actually providing some Python scripts that even help you further with that to automate the step a bit. So it's not completely automated, it is kind of automated. And this Python scripts, there's one to migrate the dashboards, one to migrate all the alerting configuration, and then one to check if I successfully and completely uninstalled the old V1 monitoring. And they basically connect to the Rancher API. I give it the correct cluster ID, and it then tells me what to do. So let's have a look. And I should probably that. So let's copy and paste this before I do any errors. The first one would be migrating the dashboards. So I exported an API token and the correct cluster ID already in my current environment. So we can have a look if we say echo cluster ID. It's this one, and also let's change the kube context to the right one again. And maybe let's go in this temp directory here. I won't show you the API token now, but believe me, it's also already there in my current environment. And the cluster ID, you can also see it's the one here in the URL, so it's CJK7VM. And this is the one I exported here. So if we run now this first script, this is just running this Python script inside of a Docker container, and it's running the migrate dashboards script. And I'm now piping the output into a YAML file. So here it says me, hey, run this image, run this migrate dashboard script, connect to this Rancher URL with this API token, and please migrate all dashboards of the monitoring system, of all monitoring systems of this cluster ID. And this actually is taking some time because it has to go through, it connects to all the Grafana instances of the cluster monitoring and all project monitorings. And then it looks at all the dashboards and figures out which are the ones that are actually custom and it should export. And these are kind of large. That's why it takes a couple minutes to or a couple seconds to actually go through all of them, look at them, and export them correctly. Sorry. While this is running in the background, let's have a look at the second command here. And this one is basically the same, then calls the migrate rules script that then goes through all the alerting configuration and all the alerting rules that I created customly. And also I can pipe the output directly, maybe in a rules YAML file. This should be a bit quicker. We can, of course, also have a look what it created. So in this temp directory, I now have a dashboards YAML file, which is very similar to what we saw before. We have a config map with this Grafana dashboard 1 label, with the kettle dashboards namespace, and the JSON representation of this Redis dashboard that we just imported. And the rules YAML file, you can see it has some comments in there. But then it also has some alerting configuration here and our Prometheus rule, which is Redis down alerting rule that we just created. Okay, last step is we now have to uninstall the V1 monitoring, and we have this check script here that we can also just point at our cluster, and this will now check if the monitoring V1 is still installed. And if it is, it will also give me pointers and URLs where I need to click to actually disable it. So let's go through this. The first thing is that we should delete is our notifier here. And before we have to delete the notifier, we actually have to delete the alerts. That makes sense. So let's go in here. Let's delete the alerts in here. And now that the alerts are away, we can go to our notifiers and actually delete the notifier. Then we can go into our default project. We can disable the project monitoring. Yep, I'm sure I want to disable it. And once we did this, we can go to the cluster and disable the cluster monitoring. Okay, let's quickly check, maybe back into the system project, if the monitoring applications have been removed and they are in the process of removing. So once they are cleaned up, I can run my check script again to see if really everything is okay. So let's run this again. And ideally, this should say now, yeah, monitoring V1 does not appear to exist in the cluster. Migration to monitoring V2 should be possible now. So this way, I have completely uninstalled everything. Important to remember, you have to delete all the alerts that have notifiers. You have to delete all the notifiers and then disable all project and cluster monitorings. And now that I did this, I can go into the Cluster Explorer. By the way, the scraping information for that it should scrape the Redis, that one we actually don't have to export because that stays into the class in the cluster. So we still have our service monitor here for Redis card that we created through the UI 12 minutes ago. That one still remains, and this will be picked up automatically by the V2 monitoring. So this is actually one step where we don't have to do manual steps. And now, if we go, I have to go to the correct, if you go in here, we go to monitoring and we install our monitoring application. This will take a couple minutes, or maybe like a minute or so, until this is completely installed and all our monitoring applications are up and running. But we can already, while this is now installing in the background, we can already start adding our customizations again. So we can say kubectl apply -f rules YAML to get our complete alerting configuration in there. And we can also add our dashboards to the cluster again. So the custom dashboard that we created. And since this is here now, we just have to wait for Grafana and Prometheus to come up successfully. Can maybe keep this here open and maybe go directly into the monitoring system already. You can see that the services are not up and running. That's why they are grayed out here, because it's just installing. But what you can already see, if we go here to service monitors, there is our Redis service monitor still in here. If we go to rules, there is our, where is it? Oh, this is hard to see. Let's close this. This should be done in a second. Did I not do this correctly? Well, I would have expected, what was it called? Ah, okay. The alerting group, what was actually called, something I did not provide customly, but here is our Prometheus rule in here already. And here's our Redis down alert. So this was all created. We actually also have now our dummy receiver with this webhook in here. So this is in here. And we even have one route to route the alert of this alert group that we created to this dummy receiver. So this was all replicated. And if we now go to, for example, our Prometheus instance in the new cluster, we see our alert is here. That worked. We also can go to our Grafana instance. And in here, we just installed it, but our Redis dashboard also appeared. And if we go back the last 5 minutes, it should also, yeah, it starts appearing data. So yeah, it takes some manual steps, and you maybe also then want to revisit things like things that are created automatically, like titles of these dashboards. Maybe also you may want to customize things. If we go into this alert again, maybe things like these annotations, because this automatically generated message is probably not the nicest one, but you have all the information in here. And yeah, that's basically what I wanted to show you, how you can customize and the monitoring V2, and how you can migrate all the customizations in V1 to monitoring V2. And for the people who need to leave us now, because we are basically already a bit over the hour, nearly to the 70, 75 minutes that Connie was talking about, thank you for your attendance. But otherwise, we can go and answer as many questions as possible, David.
Thanks. Yes, a few questions have come up. There's been a lot of interest in that GitHub repo that you've got. Is it possible that we can share that? I think I've found it, Rancher-2.5 monitoring.
Yeah, basically. So I will post this into the chat directly if you haven't done so. So the first one I'm posting is the one with the monitoring migration script, if that is interesting. And the other one is, let's see, monitoring. Yeah, this one here. I posted them into the chat, but the links are also in the slides, and you will receive the slides also via email tomorrow.
Excellent. Another question has been asked, are we going to go over the RBAC changes in monitoring V2?
I was not planning to, because that probably takes another like half an hour to talk about role-based access control. One big difference is that currently in 2.5 in the V2 monitoring, there is no built-in way to do a project monitoring approach where you have a multi-tenancy monitoring within the cluster that you can install with a click. Out of the box, you have cluster-wide monitoring stack, and you can, with role-based access control, configure who should be allowed to access Grafana and Prometheus. That you can configure. And you, of course, can also configure who should be able to customize the configuration of the monitoring. So who should be able to create service monitors in which namespaces, who should be able to create pod monitors, alerting rules, that you can freely configure. You can even do things directly if you want to, with role-based access control out of the box, where you can say, okay, a service monitor here, like this Redis card service monitor, should only be able to scrape services that are in the same namespace as a service monitor, so that someone from Team A can't start scraping services and applications from Team B. So this is also possible. And the documentation here goes into a lot more detail about this, about the role-based access control and the different roles that come with it. What is currently not possible is out of the box that I can have a system where I have multiple projects in my cluster, and I have a Grafana for project A and a Grafana for project B, and then users of the Grafana from project A can only access monitoring data from project A, and users from project B can only access monitoring data from project B from the Grafana. So at the moment, as soon as someone has access to this Prometheus or that Grafana here, they have access to all the monitoring data from the complete cluster. But what you could do, and what is exposed in the end, you could, it's not possible with a click at the moment, at least. We are thinking about the best way how to do this also in a way that is not consuming too much resources and maybe also works well for these edge use cases and federation. So let's see what comes out of that. But what you, of course, nowadays already can do, you could just say, okay, I'm creating additional Prometheus instances. For example, I want to deploy a second Prometheus inside the same cluster for project A. Maybe then have a Grafana that can directly connect to it, to project A as well. So there is a bit of custom things you have to do. So it is possible to replicate, but it's not directly clickable. I hope that helped a bit. If you have any kind of requirements with role-based access control and multi-tenancy, I would also be happy if you can just send me the information over Slack or so, and then I can forward all this also to our engineering product management as feedback from the community. That's always very helpful.
So in terms of questions, I think that's just about it. There's another question about, well, another question about multi-tenancy, but I believe we've kind of already covered that. So I think I'll just say if there's any further elaboration required, please reach out to us over Slack. We'll be more than happy to have a more in-depth conversation about it.
Yeah, it is always often like, it's hard to talk about this in specifics, especially with multi-tenancy, the same with federation, because the use cases are so different, and depending on the use case, you also need different solutions. So it's always best for these questions to actually talk about the specific use case. That makes it a lot easier. Okay, if there are no more questions, then yeah, thanks again for joining the webinar, for your attention, for all the great questions. Thanks for David for taking care of them and helping me out with that. I probably couldn't have followed and answered that during the presentation. Again, if there are more questions that come up in the next hour or next hours or tomorrow when you rewatch or have a look at the slides, feel free to reach out to me via Slack, just at slack.rancher.io. And do I have some? Last slide, I guess. No, just thank you. Thank you. And maybe Connie, do you have some last words or last slides that you want to talk about?
Yep, I got a couple additional resources that I'd like to share with everybody. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. Thank you, Bastian, for a great presentation and demo. And also to David for helping with the Q&A for the Q&A today. So as most of you know already, all of our products and projects are open source. So any of these things found here that Bastian mentioned today, you can head over to rancher.com and find all sorts of stuff and resources on each of these projects. And we do have a couple events coming up on a few different topics. Next Wednesday, March 17th, St. Patrick's Day, we do have our March online meetup, which will be talking about building images within your Kubernetes environments. And our next Kubernetes Masterclass will be on Tuesday, March 23rd. The time will be a little bit later that evening. So head over to rancher.com/events to sign up and for more information on both of these classes. A couple more things here. We do also have an intro training class. If today was a little bit too advanced and you wanted to take a step back, you can sign up for one of these sessions at rancher.com/training. Or if you have, if you're pretty confident in your skills, you can go ahead and get a certification and become a certified Rancher operator. You can sign up for that at academy.rancher.com. So that wraps it up for today. Thank you again, Bastian and David, for your time on today's session. And thank you to everybody who attended. We will be sending the recording and slides and some of resources from today's class in a follow-up email within the next 2 days. Have a good day.